It seems like everyone is trying to figure out not just what BRICS is,
Right.
but like what it could mean for the future for everyone, really.
Yeah, it's like trying to look ahead to a world where the balance of power is very different than it is today.
Exactly.
We're not talking about like, you know, military might anymore. It's like who controls the financial systems?
Yes. And to even begin to wrap our heads around that kind of shift,
right,
we got to decode how this de-dollarization thing is already happening.
Yeah.
Not just like a theory, but like real deals.
It's happening. Yeah.
Agreements. We'll also explore why some see BRICS as, well, a threat, basically,
yeah,
to the established order.
A threat to the way things are.
And unpack exactly whose interests are being served by that order. No spoilers, but, you know, it might not be yours.
Right, right, exactly. You might be surprised.
Okay, so let's dive into all this. You know, I think when most people hear BRICS, they just picture those five countries, right?
Of course. Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa.
But that Polish discussion brought up a key point, which is it's not just about those five anymore.
Yeah, it's way bigger. It's really a growing network of nations. Sometimes people call it BRICS Plus.
Okay.
These are countries that are not happy with the current global power dynamics, like how things work right now, especially on the economic side.
Yeah, that report really highlighted that, how the global South is, you know, gaining more and more economic power, while at the same time, the West seems to be kind of fading.
Yeah, its influence is waning.
This isn't some, like, you know, far-off prophecy. It's happening right now.
It's happening now. It's the reality.
So for decades, the global power structure has been, you know, dominated by the West.
Right.
You know, especially the U.S.
Mm-hmm.
They've got a lot of influence over these institutions like the IMF, the International Monetary Fund.
Right, which basically sets the rules of the game for the global economy.
Yeah.
It can provide financial assistance, you know, bailouts and things like that.
And BRICS is pushing back hard.
Yes.
They're saying this system is outdated.
Yeah.
It doesn't reflect the reality of the world today.
It needs to change.
There was this one comparison in the report that just blew my mind. They compared the economic growth of BRICS versus the G7, which is like...
Right. The U.S., Canada, Japan, all the, you know, big developed economies.
The big dogs. Yeah.
Yeah.
And by some measures, BRICS is already bigger, like economically.
Economically, they're bigger, but their power and influence in these global institutions, it doesn't match.
Yeah, they have way less voting power in the IMF, for example, than the G7 countries.
Exactly. Even though their economies, when you combine them all together, are larger.
And BRICS sees that as a major problem.
A big one. It's a lack of fairness, you know?
Yeah.
Lack of representation on the world stage.
And that brings us to, well, you know, the heart of the issue, really. The U.S. dollar.
The big green machine.
The world's reserve currency.
Which means basically everybody uses it for international transactions.
But going through those analyses you said,
yeah,
it really hit me that the dollar is like more than just money.
It is. It's a tool, a powerful tool.
A weapon, almost.
Yeah, sometimes it's wielded like a weapon, actually. Look at, you know what's been going on with asset freezes?
No, asset freezes. You have to break that down for me and for our listener.
Sure. So basically it means the U.S. can block a country's access to its own funds.
Oh, wow.
Money that's held in U.S. banks.
That's wild.
Or financial institutions.
Wow.
It's a way of, you know, putting pressure on them. It can cripple an economy. And we're not talking ancient history here. This is happening right now. Think about Iran, Venezuela, even Afghanistan.
So that shows you how much power is tied up with the dollar.
Exactly. And with the U.S.
Okay. And then there's this whole idea of exorbitant privilege, which honestly, I'm like,
I know it sounds.
It makes my eyes glaze over every time I hear it.
Right.
Yeah.
It's jargon.
Yeah.
But it's not that complicated. Basically, it means the U.S. gets special benefits because the dollar is the world's reserve currency.
Okay.
Like, they can print more money when their economy is in trouble.
Oh, right.
Which leads to inflation.
But that affects everybody, not just them.
It affects prices globally. It's kind of like they get to make the rules, but they don't have to follow them, you know?
Yeah, yeah. One of those academic papers you sent, it highlighted how capital, you know, like money investments,
yeah,
tends to flow out of developing countries.
Right, and into the U.S. or Europe.
And what's crazy is this happens even if it's bad for those countries.
Yeah. Even if it hurts their economies.
Like, what? Why would that happen?
Well, that's the thing, right? That's why we're having this conversation. It makes you ask, where is your money going?
Yeah.
Is it helping your community? Or is it propping up a system that might not be good for you in the long run?
So this is where this de-dollarization thing comes in, right?
Yeah.
Some people, I think, they hear that and they think like conspiracy theory.
Right.
But it's real.
Oh, it's very real. It's already happening. We're seeing countries taking concrete steps to move away from the dollar.
So like how? Give us some examples.
Well, we've got China and Russia, right? They do more than 90% of their trade with each other using their own currencies.
So they're just like cutting out the dollar completely.
Yeah, they're sidestepping it entirely. India and the UAE, they're settling oil transactions in rupees.
Oh, wow.
And there are some initiatives popping up in Southeast Asia and Africa to develop like regional currencies and payment systems.
So how does that actually work? Like, what are the mechanics of actually ditching the dollar?
Well, they're creating alternatives.
Okay.
So for one thing, they're developing new systems for international financial messaging.
What does that even mean?
You know, like to replace SWIFT.
What SWIFT? Some of us don't speak fluent finances here.
Oh, right. Sorry. SWIFT stands for the Society for Worldwide Interbank Financial Telecommunication.
Okay.
It's essentially the messaging system that banks use to talk to each other.
Yeah.
For international transfers. It's like the email system for global finance.
Okay.
But right now, the U.S. has a lot of control over it. So BRICS is looking at building their own SWIFT.
Their own system, so they don't have to go through, you know, the U.S., essentially.
Exactly. Give them more independence.
Okay, that makes sense. So new messaging systems, what else?
Well, a lot of countries are doing these bilateral currency swap agreements.
Okay.
Basically, deals to trade with each other directly using their own currency. So again, no need for the dollar.
Cut out the middleman.
Yeah, exactly. And then there's this really cool project called Project Dunbar, which I think could be a real game changer.
Project Dunbar. That sounds a little scary. Like something out of a spy movie.
It does, doesn't it?
Yeah.
But it's actually being developed by the Bank for International Settlements, the BIS.
Okay.
Which is like the central bank for central banks, if that makes sense.
Okay.
And their goal is to create this platform
that
would connect different countries' central bank digital currencies.
Ooh, now you're just using big words to confuse me.
All right, all right. CBDCs, right?
Yeah. What are those?
So think of it like this. A CBDC is like digital cash.
Okay.
That's issued directly by a country's central bank.
So like instead of dollars or euros or whatever,
countries
could use their own digital currencies for international trade.
Exactly. And Project Dunbar would make it easier for all those different digital currencies to work together, to be exchanged. Imagine like faster transactions, cheaper, and even maybe better interest rates than your bank gives you.
Wow.
It could be huge for the average person.
I could see why Wall Street is not too happy about this whole CBDC thing.
Right, because if people can hold accounts directly with the central bank and get paid decent interest, it cuts out the middleman, which is them, the commercial banks.
Yeah, yeah, that's a threat to their profits.
Exactly, but it could be really good for regular people.
Interesting, so we've got de-dollarization happening like in real life.
Mm-hmm.
But what's the like big picture goal here?
Yeah.
What kind of system is BRICS actually trying to build?
Yeah. Well, their report talks about this multi-currency system.
Yeah.
It doesn't necessarily mean getting rid of the dollar altogether.
Okay.
But it's about creating a world where countries have more choice.
Okay.
More flexibility in how they do trade, how they manage their finances.
So it's like imagine a world where countries don't have to use the dollar. They could choose to use other currencies.
Or their own currency.
Or even like a basket of different currencies.
Yeah, a mix. Whatever works best for their needs.
And that would, I guess, create a more level playing field.
That's the idea. Reduce dependence on any one country.
Gotcha.
Make the whole system more resilient, more inclusive.
I like it. But, you know, we got to talk about the elephant in the room here.
Yeah.
A BRICS currency.
A big one.
Is that a real possibility?
Well, the report acknowledges the idea. But it's definitely a long-term goal.
Yeah.
You know, creating a new currency that the whole world accepts.
Yeah.
That's huge. Technically, politically, you name it. Lots of hurdles to overcome.
There's also this other concept, SDRs.
Right. Special drawing rights.
Which kind of already act like a global currency, right?
Kind of. They're like international reserve assets created by the IMF.
So are SDRs the answer then? Could they just replace the dollar?
Well, they have some potential, but right now they're still controlled by the IMF, which, as we said, is heavily influenced by the West. The report suggests maybe reforming SDRs.
Okay.
could be a way to deal with the dollar's dominance.
Interesting.
Yeah.
This is where it gets really trippy. Back in 1944, this economist, John Maynard Keynes.
Oh, yeah, Keynes.
He proposed a global currency called Bancor.
Wow. I'd forgotten about that.
And it's very similar to the SDR concept.
It's amazing how these ideas, they've been around for ages.
It makes you think maybe they were just pushed aside.
Because they were too radical at the time.
Because they threatened the established order.
Exactly. But now, with BRICS challenging that order, suddenly these old ideas are back on the table. Makes you wonder, what other possibilities have we missed?
Okay, let's shift gears a bit.
Yeah.
Zoom in on Poland.
Okay.
You share those recordings of a discussion there.
Right.
And it was really interesting to hear how they're, like, processing all of this. They're kind of caught in the middle of this whole power shift.
Yeah, Poland's in a very unique position. Historically, they've always been between East and West, trying to figure out their own way.
Always fighting for their own identity.
Exactly. Now they're in the EU, so they're part of the Western sphere.
Right.
But they're also feeling this pull from BRICS, this new energy.
The discussion wasn't all theoretical either. People were talking about their anxieties.
Very real anxieties.
About what this means for their actual lives.
Absolutely. And also opportunities.
Yeah.
It's like they're at a crossroads.
Try and figure out which path to take.
Do they stick with the EU, even with all its problems? Or do they embrace something new, even if it's, you know, uncertain?
It's a tough spot to be in. And a lot of countries are facing this right now.
Yeah. It's a global dilemma.
They also brought up some what-if scenarios.
Oh, yeah.
Like missed opportunities. There was a lot of talk about the city of Udu.
Okay.
And its potential to become a major hub on China's Belt and Road Initiative.
Oh, right. Which is a huge infrastructure project.
A massive global project. A lot of people see that as like China extending its influence.
Right.
But it seems like that opportunity kind of fizzled out.
Interesting. So it makes you think, what other possibilities are we missing right now?
Yeah.
Because we're stuck in old ways of thinking.
That's what BRICS is forcing us to do, I think.
It is. It's a challenge.
Reassess our assumptions. Look at things from a new perspective.
The world is changing, whether we like it or not.
The question is, will we adapt?
Or cling to a system that might not be working anymore?
Well, we've definitely gone deep here.
We have.
And it's clear that BRICS is not just some, like, you know, passing trend.
This is a fundamental shift.
This is a big deal. This is a fundamental shift in like how power works in the world.
And it raises more questions than it answers.
Way more questions than answers.
Which is why we're having this conversation.
So let's pause here. Let all that sink in. We'll be right back with more on this in part two.
Looking forward to it. We'll come back. So we've laid out this whole BRICS landscape. You know, the dollar's power, this whole de-dollarization thing, the vision for us, like a whole new world order.
Right, right.
Now, let's talk about like you.
Yeah, let's bring it all home.
Like, what does this mean for you, for your life?
Yeah. What makes these deep dives so fascinating is that it's not just like some abstract theories or like geopolitical chess moves.
Yeah.
It's about how these big global shifts affect our everyday lives.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the future we're all kind of building together.
It's about your future. And that's what they were talking about in Poland.
Yeah, that really came through in that discussion.
It wasn't just, you know, professors and experts talking. It was regular people.
Yeah.
Sharing their hopes, their fears, their anxieties.
What this all means for them.
Yeah, like their lives, their identity, their future, really deep stuff.
It's kind of existential, isn't it?
It is.
Like, where do we fit in?
Yeah, what do we believe in a world that feels so, so uncertain.
They talked about feeling stuck between these competing forces, like the pull of the West, the EU, all that.
Yeah, the familiar.
And then this new dynamic with BRICS.
With BRICS. And it made me wonder, are we witnessing a clash of ideologies? Or is it something like even deeper?
I don't know. Maybe it's a clash of narratives.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the West has been pushing a certain story for decades about globalization, about progress, about, you know, a U.S.-led world.
The American dream.
Exactly. And now BRICS is offering a different story.
The counter-narrative.
Yeah. Challenging all those assumptions.
And it's not just happening on the global stage.
No.
These narratives, these stories, they filter down into our lives, right?
Absolutely. Did
they shape how we see the world, the choices we make, who we think we are, what's possible?
So let's get real here.
Yeah.
Think about this. Are you okay with how the current financial system works?
Yeah.
Does it feel fair?
Does it benefit you?
Think about what we've been talking about, this exorbitant privilege of the dollar.
The power of sanctions, the way money seems to always flow from poorer countries to richer countries.
Yeah. Like, why is that?
Does that seem right to you? Does it seem fair?
We've talked about BRICS' vision of this, like, multi-currency world.
Right.
Where the dollar isn't the only game in town.
Yeah.
Does that sound better to you?
More fair.
More equitable. What are your hopes, your concerns about that kind of system?
And remember that thing about maybe settling trade imbalances with grain?
Yeah. That was so wild.
It's wild, right. But it shows you how differently BRICS is thinking.
Totally.
About value. It's not just about, like, financial instruments.
Right. It's not just about money.
It's about real things.
It's about stuff people actually need to live,
to
survive.
Like bartering, but on a global scale.
Yeah. Makes you wonder, like, what if we valued things differently?
Right.
What if we prioritized, you know, cooperation instead of competition?
Yeah. Or sustainability instead of just profit.
These are huge questions.
They are, but they're worth asking.
Yeah. And that's what these deep dives are all about. It's not about, like, us giving you all the answers.
No, not at all. It's about giving you the tools to ask better questions.
Yes, to think critically about the systems that we're all part of.
So the big question is, what are you going to do with this knowledge? This isn't just a spectator sport, right?
We're all players in this game, whether we know it or not.
The choices we make, the things we buy, the companies we support.
Yeah.
They all shape the world.
They all have consequences. That Polish discussion really emphasized that, you know, history isn't set in stone.
No.
It's made by people.
By our actions. By the ideas we believe in.
And they were saying, hey, the future is not predetermined.
We can change it. We can create something new, something better.
So let's use our imaginations here.
Yeah.
If you could design a world that worked for everyone, what would it look like?
What would you change?
What would the rules be? Would we focus on cooperation over competition?
Sustainability over, you know, just making a quick buck?
Would we, like, rethink how we value things? Like resources, labor, even time itself.
Think about this multi-currency system. Could that create more opportunities for everyone?
Yeah.
What would that mean for you, for your own finances? What about this idea of trading in, like, real things, commodities?
Yeah, yeah.
Could that lead to a more stable economy, a more fair one?
We're not looking for, like, perfect answers here.
No, not at all. This is about expanding your thinking, thinking outside the box.
What kind of future do you want?
This is where we hand the mic over to you.
Yeah. This deep dive isn't just about us talking at you.
It's about sparking something in you.
Yeah, your own curiosity.
Making you think for yourself.
What do you think the future should look like?
So go back to those sources you sent us. Read them again. Talk to your friends.
Yeah, talk to your family.
Your community. What are they worried about? What are they excited about?
Well, what can we do, like, together to build a future that reflects our values?
This is just the beginning.
Yeah, we'll pick this back up in part three.
But for now.
Keep thinking, keep questioning, and keep imagining. Okay, we're back. Final part of this BRICS deep dive.
It's been a journey.
We've covered so much ground. De-dollarization, this whole idea of a new world order.
Right, right.
We even asked you, dear listener, to imagine, like, what a better world could actually look like.
Dream big.
But there's this one piece, I think, that we haven't really explored fully.
Yeah, the human element.
The human element, yeah.
Yeah.
All these, you know, these systems, the structures, the big visions, it's all, like, ultimately shaped by people.
It is.
By us. Our choices, our actions.
Our beliefs.
Yeah.
What we think is right. What we think is important.
That's what I kept thinking about with that Polish discussion. They weren't just talking about theory.
Yeah.
You know, they were wrestling with these real, like, hopes, fears, anxieties about what it all means for their lives.
Right.
Like their day-to-day existence.
Yeah, it's like almost existential, isn't it?
Yeah.
We're all trying to figure out, like, where we fit in.
What do we believe in?
What do we stand for in a world that's changing so fast?
They talked about that feeling of being stuck between, like, these different forces.
Right.
You know, the West, the EU, all that.
The familiar.
The familiar, yeah.
What they know.
And then this new energy.
With BRICS.
With BRICS, yeah.
Yeah.
And it made me think, I don't know, is this a clash of ideologies? Or is it something, like, deeper than that?
Hmm. It's a good question. Maybe it's, I don't know, a clash of narratives.
Oh, that's good.
You know, like the West has been telling this story
yeah.
for a long time about globalization, about progress, about the, you know, the benefits of like a U.S.-led world.
Right. The American dream, basically.
Right. And BRICS is saying, hey, there's a different story.
A different way.
A different way. Challenging that whole narrative.
And it's not just like happening up there on the global stage.
No, it trickles down.
Yeah, it trickles down into all of our lives.
Right into your living room.
It shapes how we see things, the choices we make, even like who we think we are, what's possible. So that brings us back to that final like thought-provoking thing
right.
that we want to leave you with. That idea from that Polish discussion about thinking differently about the future.
Yeah.
Like using history as a guide.
Yeah.
But not letting it like box you in.
Right.
They were saying, hey, the future isn't written yet.
We get to write it together.
So we're going to throw that back to you, listener.
Yeah, you.
If you could, like, hit reset, design a world that actually worked for everyone.
A better world.
What would that look like?
What would you change?
What would be the, like, the guiding principles?
Yeah.
Cooperation instead of competition.
Maybe.
Sustainability instead of just making a quick buck.
Or both. Why not both?
Would we like rethink how we value things?
Yeah.
Like, you know, resources.
Yeah.
Labor, even time itself.
Time is valuable.
Think about a multi-currency world. Could it like actually level the playing field?
Could it?
Create more opportunity for, you know, for everyone.
For people who have been excluded from the system.
Yeah. What would it mean for your own, you know, your own finances?
Your own life.
Your own security. What about trading with real things, commodities, like we talked about.
Yeah.
Could that lead to a more stable, more more fair global economy? We're not asking for like the perfect answer here.
No, no. This is about opening up your mind.
Yeah, just thinking bigger.
Thinking beyond the way things are.
Envisioning a world that reflects, you know, your values, your hopes. This whole BRICS deep dive, it's been a journey.
It has.
Not just through, like, you know, the nuts and bolts of all this stuff.
Financial jargon.
The jargon, yeah.
The acronyms.
But through the possibilities.
Yeah.
Of a future that's still being written.
It's a story we're all writing together.
So go out there and be a world builder.
Yeah, that's right.
Talk to your friends, your family. Get involved in your community.
Yeah.
Use your voice to help shape a future that's more just, more equitable, more sustainable for everyone.
That's what it's all about.
That's what it's all about. Thanks for joining us on this this deep dive.
Yeah, thanks for listening.
Keep questioning, keep imagining, and keep pushing for that better world. We'll see you next time.